Hello, I'm excited to talk with you today about estrogen creams for facial aging. So many of you have asked me, should I use an estrogen cream? And I didn't know what to say because the topic is very big. The data set, as you shall see, is very large. And I didn't want to just make stuff up like some celebrity dermatologist. So I did a deep dive. And I think you're going to be excited about this. It was interesting to go through all the data and to make some recommendations at the end. So let's start with this data set that we have. As you see from this particular review, they identified 23 peer-reviewed clinical studies just with synthetic, semi-synthetic estrogen applied topically for skin aging, 23 studies. Most, if not all of these studies were done by academic scientists who weren't selling a product. They just wanted to understand, is estrogen loss a root cause of menopausal skin symptoms, primarily sagging? So these are unbiased studies for the most part, and we have a lot to choose from. So what I did is I picked out three of these 23 studies. I picked out the ones that were done for the face, which were a small subset of the 23. And of these, I picked out the largest ones, the ones with the biggest number of subjects who treated the subjects for the longest period of time. So these three studies all treated subjects for 6 months. So you're giving the estrogen cream a real chance to work. The other study that I included was a recent study done last year by a manufacturer. Wasn't published, not peer-reviewed, but we have the entire data set, which is rare and exciting. All right, so let's check out these studies. This is the first study, the CRADY study, 1994. They studied conjugated estrogens, Premarin, 0.625 milligrams, 27 subjects, 180 days, target area face. The positives: skin thickness improved, measured objectively by ultrasound, and as evaluated by evaluators, the appearance of fine lines improved. Positive results. The limitations: the wrinkle depth actually increased. Wrinkle number did not change. Coarse wrinkles, laxity, roughness, all unchanged. And these are the telltale symptoms of menopause. Moreover, more than 40% of subjects reported safety issues. Breast pain was predominant. And this suggests that the topical estrogen is having a systemic effect. Next study, the Schmidt study. This looked at 0.01% estradiol and 0.3% estriol. 59 subjects, 180 days, face and neck. The positives: this time, wrinkle size improved, wrinkles got smaller, and measured objectively, type 3 collagen increased. Moreover, the blood levels of estrogen and FSH were unchanged. So clearly positive and different from the CRADY study in that the wrinkle size got better. The limitations: hydration measured effectively did not improve. Type 1 collagen, which makes up 80% of the collagen in the skin, did not increase. And prolactin levels increased. So one hormone did change. And there was still breast tightness in a significant percentage of subjects. All right, next study, the Fuchs study. This was 0.01% estradiol versus an active comparator, glycolic acid. 44 subjects, 180 days, face. the positives. Measured objectively, epidermal thickness increased versus baseline in the estradiol group. Epidermal integrity, measured by the length of the reed pegs connecting the epidermis to the dermis, also improved versus the baseline. And this study found limited safety issues. The limitations on both these measures, epidermal thickness and epidermal integrity, glycolic acid was numerically better. And measured objectively, there were no changes in collagen density, elastin fiber density, or inflammation. And this somewhat contradicts the collagen changes we saw in the Schmidt study. Okay, our final study is from a manufacturer, Alloy. It's not peer-reviewed, it hasn't been published, but we have the entire data set, which is awesome. 0.01% estradiol in 30 subjects, 0.3% estriol in 30 subjects, and a placebo cream in 30 subjects. 84 days looking at the face. The positives, measured objectively, they saw an improvement in skin hydration in the estradiol group and the estriol group, but not the placebo group. And there was no change in pigmentation. And this is a positive because it was feared that use of estrogen creams would cause melasma. And that did not happen. Finally, the evaluators noted an improvement in appearance with both estradiol cream and estriol cream versus placebo. So a good result. Here are the limitations. There was no change in elasticity measured objectively. And this seems to support what we've seen, which is that there is no change in collagen and elastin structure from using the estrogen supplementation. Moreover, the users rated the placebo cream as highly as they did either of the estrogen creams. So what emerges from these studies is a relatively clear and consistent picture. When you look at the improvements in the surface of the skin, hydration, inconsistent, but still benefits in one study for hydration. In all the studies, there are benefits in either fine lines or epidermis depth or epidermis integrity. So clearly, the estrogen is having an effect on the surface parameters of the skin. As we go deeper down, the results are more inconsistent. So in one study, you had an improvement in type 3 collagen, in minority collagen, but not type 1. In another study, you had no collagen improvement, no improvement in elastin density. And systematically, there's no improvement in the sagging phenotype that we see with menopausal skin. There's no improvement in elasticity, in laxity, whatever you call it, we don't see it. So this is an interesting question. Why is the efficacy limited to the surface of the skin? And I've got two ideas. One has to do with the dose. Are we delivering the right dose to the right place? The second, as we see from this slide, is there's a lot going on in women's bodies during the menopause transition. This is just a subset of the hormones that are changing over time, you see, and the ratios of the hormones change. So really the other question is estrogen enough?
So it could be the wrong dose. And what do I mean by that? I mean that either the dose is not enough or it's not getting to and staying in the place where it needs to be. So with estradiol for facial aging, the manufacturers are stuck with the 0.01% dose that was approved for vaginal atrophy. They can't go higher and they can't go lower. They have to use this concentration. And the skin of the vagina, the vulva, is very different from the skin of the face. First of all, the skin of the face is far less hormone sensitive than the skin of the vagina. Secondly, and this is really important, there are parts of the skin of the vulva where there is no stratum corneum, where it's just mucosal tissue, like the mouth. So compare that situation with the skin, where an active has to get through the stratum corneum and into the viable epidermis layers, and then it goes through those layers into the dermis and is absorbed by the blood vessels and goes into the systemic circulation. And we've seen from the clinical studies that topically applied estradiol gets into the viable epidermis. We've seen improvements in the viable epidermis. We haven't seen improvements in the dermis, and it could be because the dose of estradiol that's used doesn't spend enough time in the dermis or doesn't reach high enough concentrations before it's absorbed by the blood vessels and enters the systemic circulation. And we've seen the effects systemically as side effects. So it could be that estrogen replacement topically isn't working because it's the wrong dose. However, oral HRT also doesn't seem to work. So this was a big study that followed subjects for 4 years, and subjects either got HRT or did not get HRT, and they looked at skin wrinkles and rigidity, which is really like looking at laxity or sagging. Can estrogen replacement improve the structural elements of the skin? And what they found was that it did not. Hormone therapy does not appear to affect skin wrinkles or rigidity at most facial locations. This suggests that it's more than just estrogen. So let's take a look at this table for what's happening in the bodies of women as they go from premenopause to perimenopause to postmenopause. You see body mass index increase. You see waist circumference increase even more. You see all of these hormones, adiponectin, leptin, resistin, ghrelin, FSH, sex hormone binding globulin, estradiol, of course, and testosterone. And this is just a subset of the changes that are occurring. It's most likely not just estrogen.
All right, so we've looked at the studies. We've considered a couple of reasons as to why estrogen may not be working. What do I recommend? Should people be using estrogen creams for skin aging? Well, it depends on what position you're in. If you've already used the estrogen creams and they've helped you and you don't suffer from the systemic side effects or those don't bother you, then I think it's a good idea to stick with it. It's clearly working. You're responding. If you're thinking about trying estrogen creams, I would recommend against it. I believe that the effects that we're seeing with estrogen on the surface of the skin, we've got better options for those. Options that are just as efficacious, if not more so. For example, like glycolic acid or other peels that don't have systemic side effects. Now, what about estrogen as a root cause of the more significant symptoms of menopausal skin, the sagging, for example, the deep wrinkles, the squaring of the face? I think it's clear that estrogen is not enough. Let's go back and take a look at this chart. You see all of these analytes, all of these hormones are changing. And guess what? All of these are affecting what we consider to be central to sagging in menopause skin, which is the integrity and the function of the dermal fat cells. So what I would recommend is, instead of trying to treat all of these root causes, that we treat the proximate cause, the bloated, hypertrophied fat cell. And you don't need to buy products to do that. You can address hypertrophied fat cells through exercise, through diet, through red light therapy. There are ways to do it that are going to give you more lasting effects. And you can see our videos about menopausal skin that discuss this aspect. So I hope this episode was worth the wait. And I look forward to hearing your questions. Thank you so much for all of your support. I really appreciate it. Take care.